نعم. وأشهد أن عبده ورسوله هو خير الورى ونجم الهدى ونور العلا وشمس الضحى وبدر الدجى، أعني الحبيب محمدا المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. أرسله الله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد، وارض اللهم عن صحابة رسول الله المخلصين المحسنين المتقين، ولا سيما السابقون الأولون ومن اتبعهم بإحسان وتمسك بالثقلين إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، قال الله تعالى: بسم الله بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا. الآية في سورة الأحزاب، أن الله سبحانه وتعالى in this ayah is telling us إنما يريد. Allah wants or wills, and the will of Allah is eternal and everlasting. هذه صفات الله جل وعلا. It's not subject to change. Not subject to change, eternal and everlasting. إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس. يذهب عنكم means to take away from you, because we are human beings. Since we are human beings, that means by default and by definition, we are imperfect and we are not pure. We are sinners. Anyone is perfect among human beings? Unless those who Allah made perfect. Alayhim afdhalus salatu wassalam. Al-Anbiya, prophets. But that's an example. Then Allah wants to purify you and the household of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not only that, wa yutahhirakum tathira, and to make you very pure. Tathir, make you pure from your sins, from things that you may be vulnerable to, that other people are vulnerable to. Al ayah, when it came, when it was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as narrated in the Sahih, the authentic hadith, and Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in the house, in his house, the house of Umm Salama radiallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen. Umm Salama is one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she was this older lady that was filled like the other Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, Tahira radiallahu anha wa ardahun. They were filled with this respect, dignity, honor, and knowledge. Umm Salama رضي الله عنها, he was in his or her house, and the ayah was revealed, and he tells her, Ya Umm Salama, where is that piece of cloth? Where is that piece of cloth that I had? He was given a piece of cloth from Yemen, Rida. People gave it to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She gave it to him, and then he calls Ali ibn Abi Talib, and he calls Fatima, and he calls Al-Hasan, and he calls Al-Husayn, and he covers them, and he covers himself with this little rida, or this piece of cloth, and he said, Oh Allah, Hadith is Sahih Muslim, by the way, Oh Allah, these are my household members, Oh Allah, purify them and make them pure. Umm Salama radiallahu anha, she was not with them. She said, Ya Rasulullah, and he's still a Muslim, I'm continuing what Muslim rahmahullah said. She said, Ya Rasulullah, can I come with you under this tent? He said, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells her, Sahih Muslim, he says, stay where you are and you are deemed to good. Where you are is good, and you have a good end. Don't worry about that. And Islam, dear brothers and sisters, came to elevate the level of humanity among humans. Say, how's that? Because humans until now we are in the 21st century, many still have not learned how to be humans. Let alone, we're not talking about now, Islam says don't lie, don't cheat, don't do this. But still basic human characteristics are still missing in many people's lives. You see, insan, human being, but there is no insaniya, there is no humanity in them. You see that all the time. Therefore, you will never see any Muslim scientist from the old days, we're talking about the old days, created any weapons of mass destruction to destroy people. Islam did not come to destroy people. It doesn't matter what you believe in. Islam. The message of Islam is not a message of annihilation. If you are either with me or I will kill you if you're not with me. No, that's not how it is. Islam resents these kinds of thinking. On the contrary, Islam came to give people this freedom and to give people the intellectual space to think and to do, to lead them to the truth. Give them, help them out. That will be your problem. You don't want to believe it. But we have to give you the message. So Islam came to elevate those people. During the khutbah, people should not talk and should not come forward or backwards. Please stay where you are, wherever you are at. And the message, whatever message you have, it can't be delayed. Barakallahu fikum. طيب. Since it came to elevate the people's understanding of people, it is imperative then that we see where have we gone from that teaching and where are we now. Look at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you're talking to people who lived in the desert all their lives. The way of gaining, of eating, was with the sword and by killing and highway robbery, basically. They call it highway, there was no highway, but roads, robbery, being bandits, rough, tough kinds of life. You protect yourself and your family by the sword and by the spear. This is the kind of environment where the Prophet ﷺ was sent to, and this is the kind of people that the Prophet ﷺ had to convert to understand the level of, the elevated level of humanity and the elevated level of civilization, if we were to say so. النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم was, as you know, successful, of course, as Allah willed for him to be, to a very large extent, into converting those people who didn't believe in much, believing in the little idol they made, into believing in Allah جل وعلا, the Creator, the Lord of the Lords. That's not something easy. We might think, oh, it's very easy. It wasn't easy. And many people didn't believe. Many people did not. Not everybody believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Until now, you see it. Al-Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the Prophet for entire humanity. But still, some of those, and he is a mercy for also all the beings. But still, some of the beings still don't believe in him. It doesn't change the fact that he is their mercy and he is their Prophet. It doesn't change the fact. That fact is a fact. As-Sahaba al-Kiram radiallahu ta'ala anhum ardahum were also graduates of this school. Of the school where people were able to talk to the mind and talk to the logic and talk to the intellect of people and bridge these gaps between humanity and different human species and different human backgrounds and bridge them all together and come. Therefore, you see in Islam, you have the Arabs, you have the Ajab, you have Suhaib al-Rumi from Europe, you have Salman al-Farisi from Paris, you have Bilal al-Habashi from Africa, yani all the three continents at that time were all Muslim, and big Sahaba. The European continent represented by Suhaib al-Rumi, the eastern and that part of Iran and Pakistan and Afghanistan, which is now called all the way, represented by Salman al-Farisi and other Sahaba, and then also you have Bilal al-Habashi from Africa, everywhere, and Islam went everywhere. Ali ibn Abi Talib, and we're still, this is our third talk, inshallah, today, and our last khutbah about the Khulafa al-Rashidin, and the fourth of them, Al-Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Al-Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib was among those who were specifically and specially trained and qualified to lead such a trend among the human race, not only the Muslim Ummah. Therefore, today, I will not be talking about fadail. كلمة عجيبة. Fadail means the bounties or the things that he had. I will not, because I will be lying to you if I tell you that I can summarize to you the fadail of Ali ibn Abi Talib in 45 minutes. But I will talk today instead about the khasa'is of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Khasa'is and fadail, two different terms. Fadail means good things, good character that people have. For example, generosity. Generosity is a good character. You can say Ali ibn Abi Talib was kareem. You can say Abu Bakr was kareem, Umar رضي الله عنه was kareem, wa Athar رضي الله عنه, wa Sahaba رضي الله عنه were generous. To a certain level, of course, among different people are different. You can say brave. Say bravery, okay. People shared his qualities. But khasa'is means khasa. It means special. It means unique. So I'm going to try to summarize, even though I can't, but I will try to summarize the khasa'is, the unique qualities of Ali ibn Abi Talib that no one else shared. And that's the difference. Of course, just like any great personality in history, any great personality, look at that. Last time, we talked about Isa alayhi salam. And the Anbiya of Bani Israel, look at the prophets of Bani Israel, how many of them? Thousands and thousands and thousands. They killed them all. And if they didn't kill them, what they do? They accuse them of things. So, just like any great personality, the forces of evil will always try to create a cloud to what? To make the vision vague so you can't see. But those who have Iman, they will be able to see through with the nur of Iman. A man, before I talk about this, let me take you to a couple of things. Let me take you to the scene, and I'm going to take you back to the memoirs from the book of memory of history. And let's open up the book of memory and the memoirs of history, and let's see this scene. في المدينة. النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم is bringing the Sahaba, and he's making them brothers of each other. You are brother of this man. Be brothers. True brothers. And maybe we should do this also. Maybe in our masajid, we should get together and say, you know, we're going to designate you. Allah made us all brothers anyway. But we're going to make it a little bit more special. And I'm brother of this, and I will always be with him. And how? And batil. And I mean in batil, by preventing him from going into batil. That's how you are with him in batil. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, you are brother of this, you are brother of this, you are... Would he call the Sahaba, making the brothers of such and such? Put Sayyidina Umar, the brother of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and so on and so on. And left Ali ibn Abi Talib. And Sayyidina Ali is sitting behind, standing behind, and he's watching all the Sahaba being brothers to each other. And his eyes were watering. His tear was coming down. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam looked at him and said, what is wrong? He said, Ya Rasulullah. He said, أَحَيْدَ بَيْنَ أَصْحَابِكَ You made all your companions brothers of each other and you left me alone. There's nobody for me. And Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم looked at him and said, إِنَّمَا دَخَرْتُكَ لِنَفْسِي أَنْتَ أَخِي فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةَ I have saved, that's because I have saved you for myself. You are my brother in the dunya and you are my brother in the akhirah. And we talked about this in the beginning. In the time of Battle of Badr. In the Battle of Badr. Of course, the Battle of Badr was not a normal battle by any measure. Not by the measure of the count or the quantity of people fighting, or the quality of weapons, sticks, and two or three horses, and these guys, and Quraysh. Abu Sufyan had all these horses, there's no comparison. Okay. It's like horses at that time were like Air Force. Now we know that wars are you push the buttons and you destroy a whole nation. That's how horses, where people go on horses and they cut heads right and left. If you don't have a horse, you don't have the speed, you don't have the power, and you don't have that facility to go around and come back, you're easily killed. Muslims had few. And they said, the Imam of Sira, they say after the Battle of Badr, there were 70 people killed. 70 people.
Also, the scholars of Siyar, they said that 23 of those killed were by Ali ibn Abi Talib.
And some people of Siyar, they said, إِنَّ عَلِيًّا قَتَلَ نُصْفَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ فِي بَدْرٍ وَشَارَكَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فِي نُصْفِ الْآخَرِ. That Ali ibn Abi Talib killed half of the Mushrikeen in Badr and shared the Muslims in killing the other half.
That's why they used to call him Karrar. I don't know if you hear that title. Karrar. Karrar means he used to go on the horse like this, going through the army and come back. Make a line this way, make a line that way. That's another.
Let's go to Uhud.
And we can't really talk, I can't talk specifically because it's too many information.
In Uhud, of course, as you know, in Badr, who was the first one?
Yani in Badr, when Abu Sufyan came with the army from Mecca, he put the biggest people up, of the leaders of Kufr and Badr Kufr. Put Utba, ibn Rabi'a, wa Shayba, the brother of Utba, wal Walid,
bin Utba.
The clan of the Umayyad clan. And he said, Ya Muhammad, Abu Sufyan started the Rasulullah. So that's before he did Islam, of course.
Ya Muhammad, who is to those people?
Who are you going to look all that for you? He said, that's easy.
Hum ya Ali.
Stand up, ya Ali.
Ya Hamza.
Stand up, ya Hamza.
Al-Ha, Ubaid ibn Harith ibn Abdul Muttalib.
Another cousin of the Prophet. Stand up for all these three people.
And Sayyidina Ali was with Al-Walid.
Got him.
Hamza also got the other one. And Al-Harith was hit. Al-Harith ibn Ubaid ibn Harith ibn Abdul Muttalib was hit. And Hamza wa Ali ibn Abi Talib, they both helped and they eliminated the enemy.
That's why there was a problem. He killed these masters, these Imam of Kufr, waliyad billah.
So, therefore, as you know, the Umayyad clan swore not to take a shower or not to make any part or celebration of anything until they take revenge from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
And that's what they did. You know, they came ready.
وَطَلْحَ بْنُ أَبِي طَلْحَ
طَلْحَ بْنُ أَبِي طَلْحَ وَنَا بُمْشِرِ
comes and says, Ya Ali, or he says, who's going to fight me here?
One of those people.
In the old days, because there was no technology, the technology was in the bravery and in the sword in your hand. And there were people known that they never fought with anyone but killed him.
In other words, if fighting with such people would be what?
Almost a guaranteed suicide.
How can you fight him? He's going to kill you. Talha ibn Abi Talha was one of them.
He says, which one of you is brave enough?
Abu Bakr says, I
took his sword, went to him, injured him, and then he wanted to kill him, and the man told him, As'aluka Allah, I ask you by Allah, Ya Ali, not to kill him.
So now he turned his face. So I told him, why didn't you kill him? He said, he asked me by Allah.
Khandaq.
We're going through again
from the memory of Ghazwat al-Khandaq.
Memory. We're still talking in the memoirs.
I'm not talking. The Battle of Khandaq is talking,
telling you what happened.
Ghazwat al-Khandaq was supposed to be the eliminator of Islam. That's it. No more Muslims. We're going to. Abu Sufyan said, I'm going to make a pact with everybody in the peninsula. So he is Ghadafan from Najd.
Najd now, you know, Eastern Saudi, which is called Eastern Saudi, I suppose. That's called Najd. Brought all the people
to fight the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam along with Quraysh, and then they made a coalition with the Yahud of Bani Nadir.
Who were in Medina? From Medina.
So you have three coalition partners under the supreme leadership of Abu Sufyan, and they are come.
Now is the time to eliminate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
And they brought with them more than that. They brought with them the special elite forces. Among them, a man that the braves of men used to be scared of.
In other words, in the old days, if they wanted to scare somebody, they would tell him, you know, if you won't behave, we will call Amr ibn Wid.
Amr ibn Abdi Wid, his name. Amr ibn Abdi Wid.
Big man.
Extremely muscular, extremely powerful man that never fought anyone in his life but killed him.
Huge. Monster.
and Amr ibn Wud في الخندق,
brave enough, came with his horse and running around the Muslims.
And he's asked them, who is among you is yearning, who is looking for that Jannah that you claim?
Come out, let me see. Don't you say, he's telling the Muslims,
don't you say there's Jannah if you die? I want some of you who are willing to go to Jannah.
Come out.
وَلَقَدْ بُحِحْتُ مِنَ نِدَائِي بِجَمْعِكُمْ هَلْ مِنْ مُبَارِزٍ
And he's talking.
بُحِحْتُ means my voice, I lost my voice from calling for some of you to come out so they can
fight with me. وَلَقَفْتُ مَوَاقِفَ الشُّجْعَانِ مَوْقِفَ الْقَرْبِ مُبَارِزٍ And I stood in my position waiting for anyone to come.
إِنَّ شَجَاعَةَ فِي الْبَدَاءِ وَالْجُودُ مِنْ خَيْرِ الْغَرَائِزِ
الشجاعه he's talking Amr ibn Wud still talking
the bravery in a man and the generosity is the best of characters
and I am this I am the brave and I'm the generous I challenge you anyone
Ali ibn Abi Talib at that time if you know Fil Khandaq was about 25 26 27 years old
young man compared to Amr ibn Wud al-Amri
was the Rasulullah said ya Rasulullah let me permit me to go and fight this man. Said, no. The man keeps going, who's coming? Said, Ya Rasulullah, please permit me. And then the third time he said, Ya Rasulullah, permit me. He said, yes. And Ash-Shabalanji, rahimahullah, said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took his amama and put it on the head of Ali ibn Abi Talib and told him, go. And when he went, of course, And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at this now, another picture, another scene from the memory of Khandaq.
Ghazwat Khandaq, this is the memory.
And you see in front of you, Ali ibn Abi Talib is going, and Amr ibn Wud al-Amri, this big monster on the other side. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells the Sahaba, he said, Baraz al-Iman kulluh lil kufri kulluh. In other words, the meaning, al-Iman kulluh, the entire Iman. Is presenting the entire kufr. The whole iman is against the whole kufr. In other words, what is Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam saying? He said, not Aliyun is filled of iman. That's not what he's saying. He said, al-iman is filled with Ali ibn Abi Talib.
There is a difference. Mu Aliyun kullu iman, al-iman kullu Ali.
Therefore, those who hate Ali, they hate iman.
The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said,
al-iman is all Ali ibn Abi Talib. That's not our job. الإيمان كله
for the
كفر.
The entire كفر
is represented by Amr ibn Wud and the entire إيمان is represented by الإمام أمير المؤمنين. And the man looks at him and he said, you are coming? And he's still yelling. Amr ibn Wud is yelling. Who's coming to fight me? Who's coming to fight me? And Sayyidina Ali returned back to him. He said, لا أصلخاً. Don't be loud. فَقَدْ أَتَاكَ مُجِيبُ صَوْتِكَ غَيْرِ عَاجِزٍ
Then the one who's going to answer your call has come. And he is not capable. In other words, he is capable.
إِنِّي لَأَرْجُو أَنْ أُقِيمَ عَلَيْكَ نَائِحَةَ الْجَنَائِزِ I am wishing and I will be hearing those people who will be crying on you after just a few minutes, basically.
Is he telling him?
من ضربة علوية نجلاء يبقى ذكرها عند الهزائز.
From one sword, from Ali, he's talking about himself,
that this sword, the story of this hip that I will hit you with it, will always be mentioned whenever battles are mentioned.
And it's a fact.
He said, who are you? Amr ibn Wud, young man, who are you? He said, أنا علي بن أبي طالب. He said, يا ابن أخي, you are, I don't want to kill you. Why? I don't want to kill you because your father was like my brother. Abu Talib was like my brother. I don't want to kill you. Please go, send somebody else.
Let's send you certain death.
I don't want to. Please send me. He said, well, I'll give me I, but I want to kill you. It's not a matter of, it's not a personal matter. Rasulullah told him go. And when he told him this, he got angry, of course. Amr ibn Wud got very angry. And he came. Out of his horse, and that is when
The real thing is because now you took all the tools away from you and you are a man to man. In other words, it's almost the Sahaba, everybody is Allah Akbar, what's going to happen? And he hit him. And when he turned back on his horse, the Sahaba, everybody was saying, Allahu Akbar. And of course, one other thing before I leave the scene for you is in the old days, the way you finish your enemy is by taking his shield and what he wraps around him and his sword. This is like the last thing of humiliation that you can do after the Kimon take out. Ali ibn Talib came without taking anything. Sahaba told him, why don't you take his salab? Salab means his shield and all these things. This is a lot of money and it's so much honor to have it. He said, because he was an honorable man among his people and I hate to humiliate him. Because it's not personal. The thing is not personal. It's about la ilaha illallah. It's not about who, what I should humiliate you or you should humiliate me. It's about al-haq. Where is al-haq? Al-haq is not that, and that's it. They went and told his sister, the sister of Amr. They went and told her, you should now cry on your brother, the hero, the big man, the fighter of the fighters, the musketeer of his time. Huh? Should cry. She said, why? She said, he was killed. That time nobody believed this. Who killed him? They told her, Ali ibn Abi Talib. She said, I won't cry. لو كان قاتله غير قاتله إذن بكيت عليه دائما الأبدي لكن قاتله من لا يعاب به أبوه قد كان بيضة البلد من هاشم في المجد وهي صاعدة تميت الناس بالحسد. Because she said if his killer was someone else other than his killer then I would have cried on him all the time. But his killer was such a great man from such a noble place that it's almost an honor that he killed him, that nobody else killed him. That would have been really bad. Killed him somebody who's very honorable, because he's from Hashim, from Bani Hashim, who are in the honor are going, reaching the sky, killing the people of, with jealousy. People, anybody who goes up, have you ever seen somebody who's up, is jealous of someone who's low? It's always the one who doesn't have, is jealous of the one who has. They don't have education, they're jealous of someone who has education. Don't have money, jealous of someone who has money. Don't have health, jealous of someone who has health. Don't have wisdom, jealous of someone. But the one who has health and wisdom and all these things is not jealous of someone who doesn't have. You see? We go another scene and see, and the scenes are so many and we can't really finish them all, but we go through other scenes. Where man, narrated in Sahih Imam Muslim, by the way, and others. والحديث صحيح معروف مشهور. A man, without naming his name, because this is not the place to name names now, comes among those who used to order the people to curse Ali ibn Abi Talib. Sahih Muslim, Dakhal Fulan, one man came, said, order Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, one of the ten. He ordered him, he said, ما منعك أن تسب أبا التراب? Why don't you curse Abu Turab Ali? Abu Ali ibn Abi Talib, he had two names, well, many nicknames, but let me just tell you two of them. One of them is Abu al-Hasan, as you all know. Abu al-Hasan, or Abu al-Hasanan. And the other one was a name that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam named him Abu al-Turab. Al-Turab means sand, soil, from the soil. And the event behind this is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one time saw him, because Sayyidina Ali was not living in palaces, and he was not living in big places. He was living in places where the clean from basically the wood and mud, that's what made his house, and the floor of his house was not carpet, it was sand. And he was sleeping one time in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the sand was all over him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came and woke him up, and he started cleaning the sand off of Sayyidina Ali. Says, wake up, you father of Turab. You are the man of Turab, man of sand. And this used to be a name that Sayyidina Ali used to like. So people used to call Abu Turab. So the man, Sayyidina Muslim, so he doesn't say Ali. He says, why don't you curse Abu Turab? No. Sa'd, and remember that the Arabs, regardless of what their iman levels, of course, we're talking about dead people of all kinds of iman levels, but
regardless of what they are, at that time, there was something to say the truth.
I could disagree with you,
but that does not make me make things on you.
In other words, like, you know, nowadays people, you know, you say something, they say something, but they make up things.
They make up things from nothing. No. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas told him, well, this is Sahih Muslim, still I'm continuing the hadith. He said, I will never curse him.
I will never curse him. You can order me to curse him, but I will never curse him.
Because of three things. If I had one of these three things, then it would be better for me than the whole entire world. Humar al-ni'am, everything in the world. What are these three things? He said, I have heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam telling him in the time of Tabuk, when he left, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi ghazwa Tabuk, and that's the only time Sayyidina Ali did not go with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Otherwise, the 84, 83 ghazwa, 83 battles of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ali ibn Abi Talib was the carrier of the flag and the first sword of the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this time, the Prophet told him to stay behind. You don't go with me. And Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu wa radah, his eyes watered again. You see how a man with such greatness, but a man with such greatness and such great heart and such great wara wa taqwa. And the Prophet sometimes says, why are you doing? Why are you sad? He said, Ya Rasulullah, you left me in Medina alone and I belong in the battle with you so I can defend you. He said, Ya Ali,
Sahih Muslim still, we're still in the hadith of Sa'd.
Said, Ya Ali, أَمَا أَتَرُ اللَّهَ أَن تَكُونَ مِنِّي بِمَنْزِلَةِ هَارُونَ مِنْ مُوسَى.
What, don't you like, don't you accept to be close to me as Harun was from Musa? Harun is like the brother of Musa.
إِلَّا أَنَّهُ لَا نَبِيَ بَعْدِي. But there is no prophet after me.
You are so close to me like Harun was from Musa. But there is no prophet after me.
So you stay?
There is a reason I'm meeting you.
That's one place. Who was? And Prophet ﷺ, this is khasa'is. This is unique to Ibn Abi Talib. Nobody in Prophet ﷺ told him, you are from me like Harun was from Musa. And Sa'd is talking, he said the second thing. Yawma Khaybar, in the battle of Khaybar. In the battle of Khaybar, there are two things. Number one, the door of Khaybar, Qari al-Bab. The door of Khaybar, Khaybar, the Yahud of Khaybar, they stayed, and the Muslims, there was problems and they won, there was a fight. And they stood behind their castle, and the castle has this big, huge door that nobody can do anything. That it took 40 and some narrations, 70 people to move the door and close the door. How big? And of course, in Khaybar, the people were going. Sahaba were going, other people were going with the flag to what? To open up the door and to fight al-Yahud.
They can't come back. People go.
And then at night, Al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
still we are Sahih Muslim. Don't lose track of that.
He said, لَأُعْطِيَنَّ الرَّايَةَ غَدًا. Tomorrow, I will be giving the flag to someone. يُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. A man who loves Allah and his Prophet. وَيُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And Allah and his Prophet love him.
In return. Allahu Akbar.
He will go out, he will not come back, and he will conquer this castle of Bani Khaybar.
Sahaba, everyone.
Next day, everybody is waiting at night, saying who's it going to be, and everybody coming close to the Prophet ﷺ next day, and putting their head. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu said, I have never wished to be a leader or picked, except that day. The Prophet is telling him, not only he loves that man, not only he loves Allah and his Prophet, but Allah and his Prophet love him. And the Prophet ﷺ looks among the Sahaba the next day and he says, where is Ali ibn Abi Talib? He said, Ya Rasulullah ibn Abi Talib, he is sick. Harman, he can't see with his eyes. His eyes can't see, so maybe he can pick somebody else. He can't see.
Yeah, go call him.
What are you doing?
Bring him. He can't see, we'll see.
We'll see about that. Qurat, Ali ibn Abi Talib, they said, Rasulullah needs you. Ahmad, that's fine, come. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Sahihain, he spits on his eye, and that's from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. and with the barakah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the will of Allah. And Sayyidina Ali says, like my eye, like I can see everything, like there's nothing wrong with it. Give him, takes the flag of Muslim, gives it to him. He says, go. He says, Ya Rasulullah, how long do I go? What do I do? Should I fight them until they say La ilaha illallah? He said, Ya Ali, fight them until they say La ilaha illallah and then give them their rights.
That's why Sa'd radiallahu anhu did not say that I would not curse him because of these three things.
The third thing is, he said, when the ayah Ali Imran, فَقُلْ تَعَالُوا نَدْعُوا أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ.
And I maybe have explained this before, but the ayah Ali Imran, where the Prophet ﷺ stood in front of the Nasara of Najran in the challenge, and he said, let me call my sons and my wives or my women and myself. And when he called myself, that's again, we're still talking in Sahih Imam Muslim.
Sa'd says, he called Ali ibn Abi Talib instead of himself.
He said, it's like he made him like himself. And he said, for these three things, I will never be against Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Dear brothers and sisters, the talk about Ali ibn Abi Talib is long. And the talk about Ali ibn Abi Talib is, brings Iman and opens up the hearts, of course. Alhamdulillah.
And Muslims, regardless of what direction they take in Islam, they always have these this light of nur and light of love for Khulafa Rashidin, specifically for Ali ibn Abi Talib and the rest of them. Why? Because An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in Sahih Muslim,
La yuhibbuka illa mu'min, O Ali, only the one who has iman loves you.
And therefore, we will have iman. May Allah make us away from those in Nawasib and those who don't have iman.
Alhamdulillah, inna kathira kama amara Rasul wa la ilaha illallah wa rahmatullahi wa sharika wa sallam 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 wa sallam.
In the time of Al-Mutawakkil, Al-Abbasi, one of the Abbasi rulers, he had a son, you know, as the Abbasi ruler, just like other rulers. After Khalifa Rashida, things that became kingship.
Who's leader of who? And people, until now, unbelievable how this, and let me take just 1 minute to say this. They think being great is being, how can a man be great when he becomes leader? They didn't understand what leadership is. And from the memory of leadership, I will tell you this. They thought that leadership and greatness is having a big palace. And leadership and greatness is eating great food. And leadership and palace is wearing the most beautiful, most expensive suits and clothes. And leadership and greatness is by being tough and by being unjust on people and by scaring people. That's, they didn't see what leadership and greatness. They didn't see that the leadership and greatness that was represented by Ali ibn Abi Talib was not palaces. Sayyidina Ali, when he went to Cuba, they said, we have a palace here.
Yeah. Palace for who?
Palace for after him. After him, they are in palaces.
But before, he said, what palace?
He said, where is the masjid?
Masjid is right here.
He said, bring me some sheets of palm trees and some wood and let me live here. This is where I live.
Until now, if you go to Cuba, you see the little house he used to live in.
The clothes he used to wear, he figured and he realized and he knows, because he is the graduate of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the greatness is not what kind of clothes he wear. Therefore, he used to go with his own person who used to serve him and help him, Qanba, Ghulam.
And he used to have 5 dirhams to buy clothes for them. Now, mind you, after him, people used to buy clothes for 1,000 dirhams. So, I mean, I need 5 dirhams.
He used to go to a man, a shop he doesn't know. Assalamu alaikum. If he says, Wa alaikum assalam, ya amir al-mu'mineen,
he said, okay, you're okay, assalamu alaikum ali.
He goes to someone that he says, Wa alaikum assalam, that doesn't know him.
He said, I need 2 pieces of clothes and I have 5 dirhams.
One for 3 dirhams and 1 for 2.
He said, okay.
Gives him 2 pieces, the cheapest thing possible. He takes the 3 and gives it to his servant, and he takes the one that is worth 2 and he takes it to himself. And of course, the food and all these things happen. That one that was raising the sons for that Khalifa al-Abbasi, he used to pay him a lot of money, this ruler, Abbasi ruler, used to give him a lot of money. He said, I'm going to ask you a question.
because you know the Umayyads and the Abbasids of course were anti-Ali ibn Abi Talib specifically all of most of them يعني, so we don't say all. He said, I'm going to ask you where the ruler
Tawakkil.
He said, you have been raising my kids for years and years and I have been giving you so much money. I'm going to ask you one question. He said, what? He said, tell me by Allah, are my these kids that you raised on your, with your hands, are they more closer to you or Al-Hassan al-Hussein? Wa'ali, which ones are closer to you? And he knows that the sword is right here. He said, لَشِسْعُ نَعْلِ قَنْبَرَ لَشِسْعُ نَعْلِ قَنْبَرَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ وَإِلَى اللَّهِ مِنْكَ وَمِنْ وَلَدِكَ. The little thing that Qanbar ties his shoes with is more worthy in my eyes and according to Allah than you and both of your kids.
Qanbar is the servant of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Mawqif
is his stand, principle. And I will end with this. When Zayn al-Abidin Ali ibn Hussein was asked about his father, who are you? Who's your father? He said, who are you? Who's your father? And I'll finish all of this. Take one more minute from the time. And he said, أَنَا ابْنُ مَنْ ضَرَبَ بَيْنَ يَدَيَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ بِسَيْفَيْنَ. I am the one, I'm the son of who, of course, he's the grandson. I'm the son of who fought between the hands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with two swords. وَضَرَبَ بِرَمْحَيْنَ. And he used to fight with two spears. وبايع البيعتين. He gave the two bay'as. وصلى إلى القبلتين. And he prayed to the two qiblas from the beginning. وقاتل ببدر وأحد وحنين. And he fought in Badr وأحد and Hunain. ولم يكفر بالله قط طرفة عين. And he never became kafir throughout his entire life. He was never kafir throughout his entire life. أنا ابن صالح المؤمنين ويعسوب صالح المسلمين ويعسوب المؤمنين.
يعسوب المؤمنين is leader of mu'minin.
ووارث النبيين وإمام المتقين وسيد الساجدين وسيد العابدين. أنا ابن المحامي عن حرم المسلمين. If you don't know, Zayn al-Abidin is trying to tell them, if you want to know who I am the son of he who fought to preserve the rights of Muslim, to preserve the dignity of Muslims, to preserve the dignity of Islam and the honor of Islam.
That's who I am, the son of.
أنا ابن المحامي عن حرم المسلمين وقاتل الناكثين والقاسطين والمالقين وسهم من مرام الله على المنافقين. And I am the son of who was an arrow in the heart of Munafiqeen. Until he said, Samihun, Sakhiyun, Zahiyun, Bahiyun, Buhlul, Zakiyun, Abdahiyun, Radiyun, Farisun, Muqdam, Yabhanuhum fil Hurub, إذا ازدربت إلى سنة واختربت إلى البحر الرحى ويدروهم فيها درب الريح الهشيم, ليث الحجاز وكبش العراق وارث المشعرين وبارد الصفين الحسن والحسين. ذاك جدي علي بن أبي طالب. And really the seerah of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib cannot finish here because we have not given him his rights. But I hope that I have shed some light from the perspectives, the modern perspectives of those who follow the Sunnah and Al-Sunnah. So we can see what actually that Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib is for, not only for Al-Sunnah, for the Muslims, and not only for only the Muslims. Ali ibn Abi Talib is a leader for humanity. And Al-Kuffar also, they look like Sayyidina Ali, they take lessons from him. Those who don't believe in anything, Adventists, those who atheists, they still take and they take these pure lessons of humanity from him. And therefore, the 19th night of Ramadan, when he used to fast every day, he came to his daughter's house, Umm Kulthum. She was living with him. And he was fasting after he prayed Maghrib. And he said, give me something to eat. She gave him two plates. One plate had some desert things, you know, some plants from the desert. And the other plate has Lebanon, yogurt. He said, أم كلثوم يا بنية ارفع أحد ندامين. Take one of these two things. You want your father to stand, you want to prolong your father's stand in front of Allah the Day of Judgment? Take one of these two things. Don't give me two. Take one of them. And then next day, of course, as we mentioned, when he was praying, in his sujood, عبد الرحمن بن منجم المرادي قاتله الله عليه إن الله ما يستحق came and killed him in his head. And people heard Sayyidina Ali's voice saying, فُسْتُ وَرَبَّ الْكَعْبَةِ فُسْتُ وَرَبَّ الْكَعْبَةِ means I have succeeded by the Lord of the Kaaba. I have won by the Lord of Kaaba. I have won by the Lord of Kaaba. Because he has won martyrdom. And don't ever think that Sayyidina Ali has died. He did not die. Because the Shuhada are alive. Sayyidina Ali is still very much alive. Actually, the Shuhada, the Shaheed's life starts when he dies. In that physical sense. In that metaphorical sense, they are very much alive, and we will still take from them and learn from them. May Allah make us follow their sunnah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad.
كما صليت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم بارك لهم على محمد وآل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين وارفع يا مولانا كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم من أراد بالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه إليه ومن أراد بهم غير ذلك فاجعل دائرة السوء عليه. اللهم رد المسلمين إلى دينك ردا جميلا آتي أنفسنا تقواها وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ربنا مولاها. اشف اللهم مرضانا وعاف مبتلانا وفك أسرانا وارحم موتانا. اشف اللهم لنا ولآبائنا ولمشايخنا ولمن له حق علينا وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وعلى آله الصلاة.
اللهم ربنا ربنا لا اله الا الله اشهد ان محمدا رسول الله.